Or maybe we can wait for 5 minutes. I think people are still joining.
No, I think that you can start joining, you can start adding yourself. That's not a problem. Let's people join, no issues.
So, hi everyone, Geetika Pillai. And I've been working in telecom. Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Okay, cool. So myself, Geetika, I've been working in the telecom industry for past 10 years. And now I'm working in the IoT sector. So basically what I do is that I do small POCs in my organization and then hand over to teams for further development. So I've done POCs on messaging frameworks, then I've done further POCs on automotive. So today's session I'm going to deliver on a connected vehicle. I will give you a very brief overview of what it entails.
Yeah. And
what the future is. So I have a small presentation.
Yeah, Geetika, carry on.
So I'll share with you the presentation and then maybe we can go through it and have questions at the end. My screen is visible to all of you?
Yeah, I muted everyone, so you can just carry on.
Okay. So first of all, what is a connected vehicle? So a connected vehicle is something which is able to optimize its own operations as well as maintenance and certain other features for the passengers using onboard sensors and internet connectivity. Typically, such a car has an internet connectivity component, which we call a network access device. And then we have an in-dash system, which will show you what all is happening inside the car. Okay. Now, you must be aware of Tesla Model S. That's most probably the most well-known connected car right now. So, generally, it would feature approximately the computing power of 20 PCs and maybe hundreds of millions of code lines. So that's the kind of computational power we are looking at. Now, why should we be discussing this at all? So the connected market is for the connected car market is forecasted to be 98.4 billion by 2018. And this is from a McKinsey survey. So we have, and how it is going to reach that value. So we have various innovative features in a connected car. Like we have the remote dashboard, which is basically whatever you can do inside the car. So you want to unlock the door, lock the door. You want to turn the car on, turn the car off. All those kinds of things you get to do from a remote location. Then you have a stolen vehicle tracking. I'll be coming to details of each of these applications as we move on. And then we have a diagnostic information. So you must have heard of recalls by General Motors. They have been various at various points of time in history. Such recalls can be avoided. So if you talk of the recalls in, let's say we had, so if you guys remember, there was one recall for the auto start in General Motors. That could be avoided with a software update directly through the car. Then we come to the insurance sector, which has very interesting applications for pay-as-you-drive, which is in place right now also in some places in US. And then you have to pay how you drive. Okay, as you drive, you calculate how much distance you're traveling, actually your car. And pay how you drive will not base your decision only on the miles that you're doing, but also on the conditions of road that you're traveling on, how you're handling the car, what's the deceleration, and what's the maintenance cycle. So all those things will be counted for while calculating the premium. And then the car can be integrated with the parts supplier. So if some part has broken down, it can be ordered directly. Okay. So how do customers feel about it? So GM owners, again, many of them have requested for door unlock assistance. And again, from the McKinsey interview, approximately 90% of survey participants were ready to use a usage-based insurance policy in the US. That is if there is no risk for increasing of premiums. Okay, then we'll come to another interesting application, which is the fleet management. We'll come to it later. So we have several connected car applications. These are divided into domains like telematics, communication, location, information, entertainment, e-commerce, social networking. So telematics would be like we talked about the remote dashboard. So you can have remote diagnosis of car problem. Each of the car which is manufactured 2010 has an OBD2 port, which is the onboard diagnostic tool. And this OBD2 port generates some trouble codes whenever some problem is occurring with the car. So this can be captured online also. Right now what we do is we drive into a service station and we ask some technician to log into that. So what into that OBD2 port and capture what all problems have occurred in your car basically. So which this can be done online also if we connect the car to the internet. Okay, so there are various other applications in telematics. Then I'll come to the communication part. So communication is an interesting application is Car2X communication. Car2X is nothing but you can connect your car to any of the personal devices that you own. Maybe it's a smartphone, maybe it's your home thermostat, so it can detect the proximity. Right. And then we have location-based services. So in which we have vehicle tracking. Like if you want to track your vehicle that, let's say you've handed over your car with the driver and your children are traveling in that car. So you could track your car on the on your app, on your mobile phone app. And then we have a geofencing related to this. So what you can do is that you can create a fencing around your car. So you can say that my car can travel only from this place to that place, point A to point B and nothing else. So that what will happen is that if the car is traveling from somewhere else, so it is in some other region, then you can get an alarm. Okay. Then we have e-commerce applications. Like I talked about the pay as you drive. Then we have parking space reservations. So we can reserve parking space in advance if we are planning to visit some place. And we can have entertainment applications like music streaming. Now music streaming is an interesting application because it provides music streaming. It can be from the internet and from your personal devices which you own. So maybe from your phone you want play your list. Maybe you're listening to your playlist while you get into the car and you want the car to pick up from there only. So that can be done. And then we come to social networking. Social networking is that the car can use Twitter to publish your location. Maybe you can do an emergency call using that. Okay. So these are the kinds of applications that we have in a connected car. And I'll say these are just the tip of the iceberg. So now we are talking of a connected car, but to whom it is connected? So we have multiple options, multiple connections. And why are they connected? So vehicle may be connected to the OEM or the service providers, which is primarily for the reason that the diagnostic information of the car can be sent to the OEM. Okay. And this data can be used to either it can, generate an alarm that the car is going to break down, or maybe it can be repaired remotely also. So we have a very particular niche application in this area, which I worked on, which is the safety recall notice. Okay, so in case this application will allow the distribution of safety recalls using a DSRC protocol, which is the standard right now for connecting to cars or maybe for connecting the vehicles to infrastructure. I'll be coming to details of this protocol. So this can be used to generate the safety recall notice inside the in-vehicle infotainment unit. Okay. Now the vehicle can be connected to enterprise. Enterprise will be for the gas stations, like we have music streaming. So gas station may publish that, okay, I am the last gas station for, let's say, 100 miles now. So you better tank up. Now vehicle to X connectivity is a generic connectivity, which we have for communication with any internet capable device. Right now we are exploring opportunities with the mobile phone, but this can be any device that you own, any IoT device. Okay. Then we have vehicle to infrastructure communication. Vehicle to infrastructure communications can play important role in safer drivings. Like we can have applications. For example, we have railroad intersection warnings. So if you are approaching a railroad intersection and the manufacturer decides that you are too fast to stop at that, or maybe not notice it, you're not slowing down. So it can instruct the in-vehicle unit to alarm you to stop down or slow down. Okay. Then we have vehicle-to-vehicle communication. In this, we have vehicles which can, there was a traffic jam. You can publish that location. Yeah, you can publish that information. And that information can be used by cars behind you to on an how the car is connected. So basically at the heart of a connected car is a telematics control unit. You can see that there is different electric control unit which controls the different component car, and there is a CAN and standard for it will be TCU, which is the telematics control unit, and an in-vehicle infotainment unit, which is basically going to display all the information and also act as an info device. So something like a car music player. Okay, TCU is responsible for connecting to a telematics provider. The service provider is based on the car diagnostic information. Hello? Diagnostic information. The service provider. Yeah, any questions?
No, carry on. No questions. You carry on.
Okay. So basically, the service provider will be responsible for having information analytics engine. Okay, so it will gather information from all the cars which are connected to it, and then based on that information it can decide. So another thing is that this telematics service provider is car specific, so it is OEM specific. So a GM will have its own PSP. Similarly, a Ford will have its own PSP. So each of these OEMs will have their own PSPs, which to which the cars can connect. Okay. And now, so what happens is that through this TSP, it is receiving all the diagnostic information from each of the cars manufacturer. And let's say there is some problem. Like in the case of Tesla, what happened was that, they had this feature called a hill start feature, which is to start the car in a cold place and to assist the car in higher climbs. Okay. So they realized that when they move from, they moved to Seattle. So initially they started with Fairmont, and then they moved to Seattle, they realized that the cars would not start or the cars would not pick up speed. So what they did was they pushed an update. So this, how did they decide that the cars were, so there was some problem with the software. Because of this analytics engine, which reported this same problem with every car. Okay, so based on that information, the software patch was created and it was uploaded to the cars automatically. Okay, and then server can be connected. So now I'll come back to how the telematics control unit can connect options. First is an embedded SIM. So what can happen is that inside the TCU, we have a SIM. All Tesla cars have embedded card, which is supporting AT&T 3G. Okay, then we have a tethered. Tethered is nothing but your Wi-Fi tethering. Okay, like we do with our phones, we create a hotspot and we connect. We let the car use our phone's internet. Then it is through a smartphone. So how do we do it through smartphone? Is that we have a different application for connecting the car. You create a car. You create that connection, and then your car is So your car will act like a mirror the TCU, and then the newest option available is we do two dongle. So you plug that dongle inside your OBD2 port, which is a standard in all old cars also. So starting 2010, all cars have this OBD. And get the internet connectivity. Now, there has to be some way that the car can communicate with the network. Okay. So we have questions in here. We have cellular networks. I have short-range communication. So this is DSRC is a protocol, which is just a sec, hold on. Yeah, so DSRC is a dedicated short-range communication system which operates in the frequency band of 5.85 to 5.925 gigahertz range, having 10 megahertz, 7 channels. It is a short-range radio, and it provides a high data rate for a small area range. Okay. And further we have. So I'll come to now how this is connected to the. This we've already seen. The TCU is one. This TCU is connected.
Gitka, is it yes? A full screen? You made it a full screen because some of the people cannot. Can you make it big?
I'll try.
Okay. Carry on.
Is it better now?
You can make a bigger screen, right? Maybe you can zoom it to 200% something.
This is the largest my system will support.
No problem. Then carry on.
Yeah. Can you just make F5? F5.
This is X5.
Full screen. Yeah, X5. Yeah, just make F5. It will be full screen then in PPT. Or you have a small icon in the bottom for full screen. It will just appear as full screen. You're using, you're not using presentation mode, that's why.
Now it's in presentation mode. Is it better now?
No, this, one second, I don't know if it is. Because I can see all your, because the slide is so small, the content is becoming very, not legible.
No.
Legible.
No, maybe.
I cannot read it.
Mm-hmm.
No, just press F5. F5 in your function F. F5, that's it. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's fine now. Yeah, it's thank you. Now. Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah. So TCU, as I said, is the heart of the connected car, and it is gathering all the information from the different ECUs, which are the electronic control units, spread across the car, managing different functions like car unlock, fuel status, battery status, all those things it will be capturing and transferring it to you. Now TCU is also connected to the in-vehicle infotainment unit, which is a separate combined infotainment unit. Okay, now you can connect to, again I come back to this, so we have embedded tethered smartphone OBD2. These all connections can be available. In this diagram, I have only shown this 3G or LTE connectivity, which is an embedded TCU. Okay. Now I come back to the TCU. How the TCU is working? So basically, inside of a TCU, we have a CAN transceiver, which is responsible for receiving or sending the information from the CAN bus. Then we have a controller which can apply the information, or let's say we want to do some control tasks like locking the ECUs or clearing the trouble codes. We come in the control information. This control information will be routed again through the CAN transceiver. Then we have a vehicle gateway. Vehicle gateway is nothing but the communication gateway for the different ECUs to connect to the network access device. Okay, and the peripherals I would say will be like, so there are ECUs which are spread in the engine, and there are peripherals like you attach different things to your car. So they may also be but will be that we have some display units at the back of the front seats, if you guys have noticed. So those are connected peripherals. They each have an ECU integrated like gateway and the network access device, 2G or LTE modem, or you can call it in simpler terms. It will connect to the to the TSP service provider. Now as I talked about, there are two mechanisms, either DSRC or cellular. Now I am talking about architecture of this deployment using DSRC. So DSRC has some so there is a specification with J235 that defines the messages is going to change with the so first let me explain. So we have two kinds of units in a DSRC network. One is an onboard unit which is installed in the car, maybe inbuilt, or it may be installed later on. Okay, another unit is the DSRC RSE, which is the red equipment, which is part of infrastructure. So there may be, so let's say the traffic signal can act as a roadside infrastructure. Now, now these are the networks, network elements that the DSRC has. Again, it defines different messages, which is the, so here you see the BSM 1 and 2 messages, which are defined by DSRC. We have other messages, maybe particular to the OE, data, diagnostic information, charging information, all. And then we have in vehicle play. Okay, in vehicle play will be a receiving entity. Now the I'll not go into the details of basic safety message, but in a general way it contains information like we have the latitude, longitude of the car, so it tells the GPS coordinates, it tells the vehicle size, it tells the positional accuracy, it will tell about the transmission and speed. So generic information which might help the other cars to identify what kind of a message is being transmitted. It will also give us information like what is the path prediction, which will be used for avoiding collisions. Okay. Now we have the roadside equipment. So from the car to the DSRC roadside equipment, the wireless communication in the frequency band of 5.85 to 5.92. The channel description is also done. I think it will be out of scope of this presentation. May take another session for details. So from DSRC to the core network, we can have a wired network or a wireless network. Now we have a data aggregator which will collect all this data, and we will have an application developer which will maintain all this. So it will send, if you have a different application to be done, so let's say you want to generate new warnings, so this application developer will be using that information received from the data aggregator to do that. Now we have a certificate management entity which is used for ensuring that we are accessing the network securely. Okay, we move to scenario where we see that there's a cellular dependency. In what will happen is that we have some.
Geetika, I think right we have only last 10 minutes left on this call, right? So maybe if you can quickly come it up, right? We can ask for questions. If not, right, then we can quickly ask them. We can have a follow-up.
Okay, then maybe we can skip this part and I'll move to the, let's say this is the last only.
Okay, fine.
So we can see how that can fit. So we have a non-DSRC. I'll skip the combined one. So that is an addition of this. So the other option is cellular connectivity. In cellular connectivity, what we have is that I'll latch on to a mobile network operator and use the cellular network for communication of all the data. The path are similar. The data transfer is similarly access technology. So that's about the combination of the hybrid version is also there, which is nothing but some messages you can send on DSRC, some messages you can send on cellular. So we have inside it for connectivity in Tesla, like for in Tesla, we have a Sierra wireless modem. Then we have a LCD screen, which is a system on chip. It has a CPU, GPU and Linux cube. So there. I'll skip this part. Then we have, so what kind of data is captured? The data captured is that vehicle data, basically what kind of vehicle, what make, what other parameters, then software and system health issues. All these information will be captured. Then this I've talked about, maybe we can skip given time. Yes. So Maybe we can go to the question.
Okay, I think right, Geetika, I think right. You are done with your presentation, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so what I will do is that I'll open the floor for questions now. So I think right, it's now today is a bigger team. So I think right, whatever questions we'll have for the next 7 minutes, we can do that. So I think right now anyone can ask questions to Geetika and then we can take it from there.
Hi, Rakesh. Thanks for this presentation. It was good. This new is in this connected car, you know, some background. What I used to understand in the connected car, along, you know, giving some solutions to clients where we fix a box inside the car and kind of monitor their car usage. Basically, this was an insurance model. Back in 2010, used to do this model. How do you change is this model today? You know, are we looking at not just measuring the driver performance or anything, but also how really respond the sudden changes on the road, which will help the product to design that? Is that something that is more getting involved
basically
today?
Basically, the major change, I'll say, is the analytics engine that we are putting in place. Each of the, which I've seen from experience, is that Renault, Nissan, if we talk of. So, they were communicating with the probe data earlier also. The diagnostic information will change anyways. But now, what they've done to enhance is that they've made it friendly for lesser computational power. So, the TSP can be a lesser computational device and support the same functionalities. Okay. And the other thing is that it can connect to, so if we talk of the insurance, it's connecting to only one kind of a device. Now it can connect to a range of devices. So it can be your co-passengers, it can be infrastructure. So that's what new we are introducing here.
So when you say other, you mean your talk, this new thing to each other? Okay, okay, thank you. Thank you.
Hi, Geetika, Stanley Moses here. Great presentation. Thank you for sharing the details. I have a question more related to probably a startup type of environment. See, there are a lot of mom and pop service stations in any country. You go, you definitely have these mom and pop for cars particularly. So in terms of infrastructure, what should they look at in order to come up with a solution which will address their customers, be it a higher reliability which they want to offer, or basically just to do an continuous maintenance on their cars?
So basically, the technologies we are working on are moving towards a space where we can make those mom and pop shops redundant. Okay, so the car will be repaired automatically. You don't have to drive into some place to get it repaired. So that repair will be done at your place itself if the part is required to be replaced. And with mom and pop shops, the major problem, which is that you don't know whether the part is genuine or not, which is what the companies are really afraid of. So recently there was a case with Tesla where one person was reporting problems and he was tampering with the, so basically not directly he was taking it to some service station, local service station, and they tampered with the fuse, which was generating problems. So what they did was they made it tamper proof. So that's the kind of problems we are trying to remove. So maybe we'll not be able to help those guys right now.
So do you mean to say they would not be able to have a setup all by themselves, at least for the older cars? Is there a feasibility,
for
first of all?
Cars, it does not matter. So for the older cars, the solution is with the OBD2 dongle, so which can connect to the, which can help the older cars to connect. Now the newer cars are all coming with the embedded SIM card inside the TCU.
Okay. Okay. Thanks, Gita. Thanks for the detail.
Yeah. Thanks.
Okay, any more questions? If not, right, we can just say a few words and then we can just wrap it off for today's session. So any last question from the
team? I have one last question. I think it's Janik Rakesh again. Sorry, one last question is, Gita, how, based on your views, you know, because you're in connected car, how do you think this, autonomous car or anything that today, you know, like especially Tesla, which claims, you can remotely update your software. It's just like they made it like iPhone. Car run or increase the capacity of your car. How, it can be visible in every car company like Renault or any others. How easy for them is to adopt this kind of technology going forward? Are they going to replicate exactly what Tesla is doing, or do still have some option to do it in another way? Because I think Tesla will just eat away all these big gains in coming years if they don't work like what Tesla is doing. What the technical
I know.
Gitika, I think right we are just last 1 minute left, right? I know all of a sudden it get called off, so I think right we have to stop this question. Maybe we can talk offline on that, right? So maybe we can talk on the group or maybe another way. So I can just say a word of thanks, right? Anyhow, right? And the team, right? I know. I think, right, this is the first. Thanks, Gitika, right? I think this is the first meet. I can see a lot of audience in the meet, right? And then I see more than 25 people join this call. I appreciate everyone to join the call. And also, I think that the time matters now. I think now I got that, right? 10:30 is the time we have to call it because I see a lot of people now. And also, and it's a very great presentation, Gitika. Right? Thanks for your time. I appreciate your time. And then I have taken your time out of the difficulties, and you have presented it very well. Thanks a lot. And thanks to the team and coming and making it.